this was a guy who struggled both educationally and trying to get a job in and out of jobs, and was absolutely supported through this initiative. I suppose the reason why is that story of integration? Well, on Wirral we do have an region of 840 children who are looked after. And as a local authority, the responsibility is the corporate parent, advisory from the local authority. But as we are starting to integrate and work in partnership, it's what we can do in partnership to support these young care leavers. And my colleague Nesta has been very involved in this, in some work around social values of actually getting the NHS in line with some of these things. And we've actually got a university teaching hospital who is also taking care leavers into apprenticeship roles and different roles within the organisation. I just thought it really was a good way of demonstrating how integration is working. I don't believe that we would have been as quick to have done this had we not been working in partnership with each other. And so I do think that, you know, it's an absolute positive. But also, as well, Sam's going to be talking a little bit later around our mission and our values. And our purpose is around making a difference to people's lives. And I think the people like Ollie and care leavers that we're hospitals to take on, they will be making a difference to people's lives. I think that's something that we should be proud of, and we should be developing more. But happy for any discussion or more questions.
Thank you, Laura. I'm sure this is dear to your heart, Tom, with the care leavers. This really good news, isn't it?
Just a quick point. Chair, it'd be great if that video could be sent off. Obviously, as a partnership, we can identify that the factors that cause people to remain in a cycle of care and poverty, and we can actually use it into provide a way out through employment or support their family. It's valuable, not only financially, but it's a lot to do.
Thanks, Tom. Any other comments on that nice story? Perhaps next time we should just see the teachers. Chief Officer's report, over to you, Simon.
I'm going to keep it brief, Chair, as you normally put in written reports out as part of the pack. But really, the work over the last few weeks since we met has been focused on producing a 5-year strategy for the Wirral health and care system with our partners in provider organisations. We had a very helpful health and wellbeing board workshop last week in which we engaged partners and elected members about developing a Wirral strategy that truly reflected health and care in its widest sense and how our part in that, and really trying to focus on how we as health and care commissioners can work with other partners in impacting on the key determinants of health, particularly working with partners in terms of education, leisure, employment, economic regeneration opportunities. And I think Ollie's story just shows just then how health and care, I suppose, supported Dolly as he grew up, but as he became an adult, really, our role was very limited in the role of having a good job, having a purpose, having a wage and an employer that supported Ollie's health and wellbeing. Was really, really important. We want to ensure that our 5-year strategy links into the emerging Wirral plan and the vision of Wirral Council for our peninsula, and to make sure we avail ourselves of the opportunity that will bring in terms of economic regeneration and growth, as we think they are key to securing what we need to do in terms of improving the health and wellbeing of our borough and tackling health inequalities. So really that has been the key focus of the work of the of Wirral Health and Care Commission over the last 3 or 4 months since we last met. It's our proposal to bring that Healthy Wirral strategy here for the next meeting. It will also then go to the Health understand and own? Can we explain in public? And can they be improved? So 3.8 is the outcomes of the workshop. And it proposes that we adopt the strategic aims listed therein. So I would recommend that as World Health and Care Commissioning, through the Joint Strategic Commissioning Board, those become our strategic aims, and therefore that starts to impact upon the front sheets of documentation. You start to work towards that as aims.
Thank you, Simon. Any comments? Queries on that? Thanks very much. That sounds really sensible. Sensible idea, and I think the fact that we've had sort of cross-party comments on that really helps as well. So we're on to the Healthy Wirral Programme update, and this is yes, Simon.
Yes, so this has been authored by Julian Nair, who's the programme manager, so I'm presenting Julian's work. But the Healthy Wirral Programme Board meets every month. And this is the a summary of some of the work that's been done up until about 4 weeks ago, really, because of the timing of the reporting cycle. As you'll see within the document, there's a very strong programme governance in place now, as set out under 3.1 of the paper. We've revised the governance and infrastructure around some key deliverable programmes. We're moving towards developing an integrated care partnership type approach. We have integration and commissioning, and Paul Edwards and Graham Hopkins are coordinating that piece of work in order to bring providers closer together in terms of how they work for our system for local people. We're also, alongside the 5-year strategic plan that I mentioned in my verbal report, working on an associated financial recovery plan to return to the system to financial balance over the next few years, and that's been a significant amount of focus. And we've also had the ability to utilise some top slice allocation from clinical commissioning group budgets around a transformation fund approach that supports the delivery of some of those programmes, and that's outlined under 3.4 of the paper. We continue to work, as it states in 3.5, on the development of the neighbourhood approach. So this is again about wrapping services around the 30 to 50,000 populations where people live, work, play, and socialise. We have done considerable work over working with the approved primary care networks to ensure that they also have a level to balance in 2021 and start to deliver surpluses in 21-22 and onwards, but which has kind of almost been accepted by those as a return, but then we've been held to account for delivering far more than that in year. But that's how the system sometimes works. But that delivery is about having a system overview of that recovery and sustainability plan and presenting a system financial recovery plan, which, going back to my earlier comments about aligning capability and showing people working together, that's something we wouldn't have been in a position to produce, I don't think, even 18 months ago. So that means there's a system and I think we're in a much stronger position because of the work around healthy rural. Also appended to it is the annual report for 2018-19. We would hope that this in the future develops in terms of focusing more on some stories that people have received or been supported by our interventions. We want to have a bit more focus on the users of our services going forward. But it does detail the journey we've taken probably in just less than 18 months from the appointment of Dave Beaver as the independent chair. I appreciate we've done a lot of groundwork before that. But I think the appointment of David as the independent chair, the first meeting that reconstituted Healthy Rural Partners Board in April of last year, we've really motored since that. We've already made some significant improvements, but we're nowhere near where we want to be. So there's still that level of ambition about improving the system. So I think that's a run through the report without reading it word for word. somebody actually taking an interest in the person in the hospital bed, and making sure, you know, just simple, were the teeth cleaned, did they have somebody to speak to, were they eating properly. And I think health and care, we have become very technical in some of the stuff. We do talk about telehealth, telemedicine, etc. A lot of this can only be done by humans, by people, and having that care and attention. So I'd really like to get to a position where the experience of counselling and analysis and their family is the norm, and it isn't, so, you know, that's the standard we have to drive for. We have to make sure that everybody gets that standard.
Oh, thank you all very much for that. It's quite fitting, isn't it, for this meeting. And now I'm afraid we're on to the... there's a recommendation there. We're asked to look at the contents of the report, so I'd be happy to do that. Thank you. Now we're on to my pooled fund finance report.
Thank you, Chair. I'm afraid too. This paper sets out the proposed budget for 1928, and I've gone through double take on reading this. We've been out in September, but the timings of this are just the way they fall, partly with the later approval of the better care fund and so forth. But I'm assuming everyone's read the paper. The paper sets out the numbers. Section 4, page 2. You'll see the summary of £138, £130 million, £2 million, split between adult social care, public health, and young people, the CCG's direct expenditure and the better care fund, the £56.1 million. Section 4.2 breaks those numbers down, largely in line with previous years, and the history of the pool fund has been set out in previous papers to this joint strategic commissioning board. What I will do is bring your attention to section 5 in terms of the financial risks and challenges. We know from the previous meeting in July in the previous papers that there were some challenges in year. They were mitigated, and then we ended up with a risk share, which in terms of how you'd approach patient packages or client packages, to use a little term, it's essentially that care is provided, and we spend less time arguing about who's paying for it, but the right package is in place. And I think in the past there have been issues where we've concentrated on trying to defend our own patch, if you like, at the expense of improving the lot for patients. Section 5.1 sets out the risks as seen at this moment in time, so you'll see £4.5 million split largely, £2.5 in adult social care and £2 million across the CCG. You can see that in 5.2 we are looking at how we mitigate these pressures, and it's important, I think, to recognise that social care is seeing significant increase in demand. There is now, I think, an unargued case that the health service cannot survive sustainably without adequate social care funding, because the impact of the lack of social care funding pressures in social care and the health service. And equally, I think we can learn a lot from our social care commissioning colleagues in terms of the way packages are paid for, but also the
opportunity to consider the funding pots that we've got and the delivery models. And we've been able to release some cost savings from these new contracts, and also to refocus the service, given the move towards more integrated care, which we've heard a lot about, and reflect the new place-based care models that we've got, and also obviously the evolving health and care needs of our population. So section 3.1 of the paper outlines the budget for each of the commissions. I suppose one key risk is that there's also a risk of disruption through new service provision. But in order to mitigate this, we've left adequate time to plan for and mobilise the new service so that it can be delivered in a way to minimise that disruption. And as with the other key point is, once awarded, these contracts will be reviewed every 12 months. And there are termination clauses within the contract if we require it, either due to performance or changes in budget. So the request of the board is really to approve the awarding of these three commissions, which are 4-5. +1 +1 for the 0-19 service, or 5 years +1 +1 +1 for community substance misuse service, and but 3 years with the option to extend for again +1 +1 for community care service. Happy to answer any questions that anyone might
have. Thank you, Elsa. Are there any questions because the report is actually under the Exempt items? So if there are any questions, we'll have to ask members of the public to go first, but if there aren't any, we can approve, we can do the recommendations that Elspeth has set out, and then I can ask the members of the public to leave after that. So, any questions? Are we happy then to take recommendations that are on page 82? This is just for members of council and not for the CCG. So are you happy to agree recommendations? Yeah. Yes. As the CCG, please would just note the decision. Thank you very much. So that's the end of the agenda then. So item 10 is for exempt information, and I'll have to ask the press and the public to leave.
I've got to go.
You've got to pass a resolution as a committee rather than just a chair.
Are the committee happy to pass a resolution that we accept members of the committee?